that he was talking about the TAM and talking about the revolution and what's happening in the Silicon Valley. All I can say is to the young people that you need to dream big to come, to pursue your dream as the fast you can, but be open to have the change of your career during your lifetime. So for me, I started off as an engineer, and then actually my wife raised me. Now we had a Chinese restaurant for many, many years. So I decided to go from high tech to low tech, and eventually it was no tech land in Sacramento. So pursue your dream, and anything is possible. But put your heart and soul into it. If I can be immigrant that got elected to the state assembly, I mean, the sky is lit for all the young students here in the audience. But before I put out, I have Ash and I, we have a certificate of appreciation from the state assembly. We'd like to present it to Siobhan Puma for starting to start it 3 years ago. And
don't allow ourselves to be the technological bubble where it puts us all the intruders or silos. If I just walk down the street, I'm going to do this too, we're all looking at our phones, we're not even looking up and right? We have to find a way to move past that and allow allow us to control the technology that makes our lives better, not the other way around.
Well, let me follow up on what Assemblymember Collins just said. Technology has its ups and downs. We all use it. In fact, those of us in the government business use it for pretty much the same reason you do. We make documents, we communicate with each other, we find out where we're going, we get directions there. We're all using technology for those purposes. Also, in the government business, I know that Congressman Conant is trying to help export the approaches we take to technology to other parts of the country where many people don't have jobs. Places like the Appalachian Mountain area, the Rust Belt, the Midwest. We've had a lot of success in Silicon Valley by all doing work on technology. We're hoping we can share that with the rest of the country and make some of those people's lives brighter. But the real point I want to make sure you understand, technology is supposed to serve you. You are not supposed to serve technology. And I think sometimes we lose sight of that. We think, oh, my mother and father tell me I have to get a job in technology and then just work toward tech. The fact is, someone's going to use that technology to do something they want to do. That should be you. You should be saying, what is it I want to accomplish? And can any of this technology help me? If it can't, don't use it. If it can, use it. There was a delegation that came from China a few years ago to discuss global warming, the biggest problem in the world. And a reporter for the Chronicle asked them, well, how do you deal with the dispute over whether global warming is happening? And the response from the Chinese delegation was, all of our leaders are technically trained. We know that it's happening. We don't waste any time with those conversations. There's something to be said for a country where many of the leaders have technical backgrounds. China is really like that. Most of the leaders of China have engineering backgrounds. If you go to Europe, what do former British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, current German Chancellor Angela Merkel, and Pope Francis all have in common? No, they're not all PhDs. Angela Merkel is a PhD. But they all majored in chemistry. Margaret Thatcher majored in chemistry at Oxford. Angela Merkel has a PhD in physical chemistry, which of course I'm sympathetic to because I do too. And Pope Francis got the equivalent of a community college degree in chemistry before he went to the seminary. In Europe, scientists are elected to be leaders. In China, engineers are elected to be leaders. We need more technical people to join the huge ranks of attorneys that are our leaders in the United States. Now, when Congress and the state legislature, since their business is making laws, it makes sense that most of them should have degrees in law. Okay, that makes sense. But some of those laws relate to technology. So we need to have a few scientists and engineers in there at the same time so that the laws we make are the best we possibly can make. I heard a speech by Congressman Jerry McInerney, who majored in math at the U.S. Military Academy at West Point. And he told us that in the 1960s, he was taking a class, they started telling him about global warming and how it was going to affect military operations. That was the 1960s. And here we are in 2017, and the leaders of our country are saying, the problem doesn't exist. We need more of you to run for office again.
Michigan got transferred to IBM. So the high tech has always been part of my life.
we all work for IBM. Did you work for IBM?
I did too.
I worked there for 13 years. I know there's an IBM in Hanson.
All right, then I'll get to anybody else from IBM here. All right, anymore. All right, look at that. So, but I'll tell you what, you know, specifically, I'm an early adopter with technology. I know a bunch of stuff. I'll bore you to death. But I'll tell you what I do. When it comes to like the city of Saratoga, being a council member, you know, can you all hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. So one of the things I always talk about, just to summarize what I seek to do for the city of Saratoga, I call it providing services cheaper, faster, better. Yeah, simply stated, and essentially applying the high-tech algorithm in terms of how we not only communicate, how we do our outreach, and how do we go and get feedback from the community in making change happen in a very, very positive way. Like, for example, to get a tree permit, you know, we need to still do it on paper, we need to print it out, take a check, take it to the city office. To get a sound permit, we need to do the same. And we are basically taking some of these things online just to make it easier, because we are busy. We're all busy working in the high tech or whatever else we do. And if we can make it a little easier by providing services that you can do online, that you're sort of not contingent and dependent upon printing and taking it to the city office on a Friday afternoon finding time. So that's the way I look at the world. How can we simplify and make it easier for us to work and operate with the world? When it comes to the world of startup, so what many of us, you know, are in the startup business here. Vipin is still here. Vipin is still here? Or Vipin had to leave. So Vipin
is right here.
So Vipin actually, you know, serial entrepreneur, he just closed his Series A yesterday, you know. So those are the kind of very interesting stories that we see in the Valley. But at the end of the day, why do startups survive? Because we are catering to a customer base. We are solving a problem, and we are actually in the business of service. And that's exactly what all of us are trying to do here. When you can put your ideas, put it to service, put it to benefit, then magic can happen. And technology is a huge enabler of that. It's not everything, but it really can help us quite a bit, and that's what I see. Back to you, John.
The success of Silicon Valley over the last 40 years has been phenomenal. There are analogs of Silicon Valley popping up all around the country and all around the world. We'd like to maintain leadership in that area. As public servants, serving the government, what are some of the impediments to the success of Silicon Valley that you might be able to do something about?
Well, you know, this actually does connect to idea. I grew up a couple miles from IBM in South San Jose, where they used to have the West Coast headquarters, where the front-end disk drive was invented. And while on the council, this is how, you know, I used to go to the campus with my friends whose parents worked at IBM and play basketball and tennis and all that stuff. While on council, just in the last few years, I played a role in having that property redeveloped, still keeping some of the industry there. So Hitachi owns the land, and so Western Digital has a facility there. So still keeping 700,000 square feet of jobs of industrial land. We also added about 3,000 homes and close to 1 million square feet of retail, including a brand new Costco opening next week. Now, why do I mention that in regards to your question? Is that a couple of the major impediments to the continued growth and success of Silicon Valley are housing and transportation. You asked, maybe we do surveys of CEOs, Silicon Valley Leadership Group does surveys every year. Those are the number two issues every year. Housing costs, because if you're trying to attract talent to come here, they factor that in, just like we all factor that in for our daily costs, our daily living. All the kids here, your parents have to think about, you know, how to pay mortgage, how to pay, you know, for gas, how to pay, you know, for a car, and all those things. Well, that's the same thing that everybody that comes here thinks about, right? And so the CEOs are worried that, wait a minute, it's going to get harder and harder for us to compete with Austin, with North Carolina, with other countries that are certainly a lot less expensive. So we have to do something about housing costs, and then transportation. Isn't it a little bit harder to get around now when you're driving than it was 5-10 years ago, right? It's obvious, we see it. So bringing BART to San Jose, for example, is such a huge objective. And it's going to be opening in San Jose this year, in very essence. Caltrain is very important. All these regional transportation connections that connect all of us up here. And the Congress member has to be concerned about that, because one of his primary focuses is, again, as mentioned, job growth and making sure that you remain an epicenter of innovation. Well, if you want to innovate, you have to make sure people can get to where they need to go, get to work, make sure they can afford to live there, and all those things. Saratoga, although it's in West County, it's a smaller city, and I'm here in San Jose, which is a very big city, but what I do and what San Jose does impacts Saratoga and vice versa. So those are issues that we're going to have to think about that are really difficult to figure out, but we've been working on them for a number of years, and I think that those are kind of physical impediments to Silicon Valley. And I'll allow my friends up here to talk about maybe other elements that may challenge Silicon Valley.
Well, actually, I'd like to follow up on what the assembly member just said. I saw a presentation by the Silicon Valley Leadership Group, the organization of the large corporations around here, and it was exactly his question. Here's the other competitors to Silicon Valley across the nation. You mentioned a couple of them. Research Triangle Park in North Carolina, Austin, Texas, Route 128 around Boston, Portland, Seattle. How do we stay number one? What are the advantages and disadvantages we have? And the assembly member just mentioned the major disadvantages we have is the fraction of our life we spend sitting in our cars. The other places, people don't have to spend as much of their life sitting in their car. This area is overpopulated. It's overpopulated. You will hear many people talk about the jobs-housing ratio. As all of you technically trained people know, if you want to change a ratio, you can change either the numerator or the denominator. You don't just have to change the denominator. They're all saying, more housing, more housing, more housing. Well, maybe what we need to do is adjust jobs as well as housing. Maybe we've maxed out on how much this area can support. How can we arrange for our successful companies to grow without going up and up and up and sprawling and sprawling and sprawling? Of course, one thing is, let's make an analogy with a family. All right, let's say we're very successful at creating more like us and we have a bunch of kids. Great, now they all live in the house. The house starts getting more and more crowded. All right, let's say they all have kids. All right, now the house is getting really, really, really crowded. Maybe at some point we should say, let's find another place where you could go and thrive, that the birds could leave the nest, and we can help launch other Silicon Valley. So I'm going to suggest that maybe the answer isn't that we have to be the biggest of all the Silicon Valleys. Maybe we can be the one that teaches other places how to be a Silicon Valley. And that we can focus on the quality of life of people who live here. So that when we want to get the best people, they'll say, wow, it's really nice to live here. We win on climate. We certainly have great universities. You know, this whole valley was started because of Stanford University. Hewlett and Packard asked their professor, where should we start our company? And he goes, why don't you start it right here in Palo Alto? And then they did. And then that built up from there. And it's been such a success. Every one of our cities likes to put Silicon Valley in its title. You know, San Jose calls itself the capital of Silicon Valley. Palo Alto is the birthplace of Silicon Valley. In Sunnyvale, where I was on the city council, the heart of Silicon Valley. It's a good brand, okay? But in order to maintain how good that brand is, we have to make sure we keep the quality of life for people high. We have to work on both the jobs and the housing part of that job and housing ratio. And we should be willing to say, let's launch other ones. It's not bad that there's an Austin and a Portland and a Research Triangle Park. I would say that's good, right? The more parts of America that can benefit from this, the happier people will be. And the less likely they will be to go to the polls and say, I want to send a message and vote wrong.
Startups, because this is what who we are. This is part of our DNA. That's the reason why all of us talk here. We need to have many more startups. But at the same time, we need to look at solving the housing and really the transportation problem. How can we solve the transportation problem? That's where the policy comes in, right? So when you look at the autonomous driving, you know, right now our cars, we utilize 5% of the time. You know, we all use it during rush hour. We, you know, we clog the freeways. It's become a significant problem. But with the whole autonomous driving, we will actually increase the utilization of the cars to 20%, where we will all stop having and owning cars. You know, the Ubers of the world may take over. We don't know how it's going to work out, but as soon as like 10 years, you will have cars without steering wheels. It's hard to really imagine that, but we will have cars without steering wheels in as soon as like 10 to 15 years. And if we can roll out that piece of technology, right now, I think, you know, there is a startup every week happening in Silicon Valley that's actually working on a facet of the autonomous driving problem, right? There are startups happening every week. But to some extent, Nevada is actually beating us at the game. You know, you have the city of Columbus, Ohio, that actually won a big smart cities award. And they are actually, there's an innovation economy. They have a 30-mile stretch, but they are trying to test out autonomous trucks because there are so many trucks that go through Ohio. So I'll tell you what, Silicon Valley has been beaten by states like Nevada, by states like Ohio. So I think there is an opportunity for both Congressman Khanna and for Ash Kalra to basically go out and see how we can have policies in our state that will help create that innovation economy to help these kind of companies thrive and grow. I think we're doing pretty good, but we are kind of falling behind. So that's the opportunity that we have, and I would love to see that happen. Back to you.
I grew up here, I came here as a little kid way back in 1978, and this place has changed a lot. And for those growing up here now, and actually, you know, Chris alluded to this earlier about finding what it is that you want to do, right? And there's a lot of pressure on kids these days. And sometimes they don't talk about that, but there's a lot of pressure on kids to follow certain expectations and be successful by certain definitions of success. I think that we all would benefit, the parents and the kids together, if we all allowed our kids some space to find out who they are and what it is they want to do with their lives. So that's kind of a message to both the kids and the parents. All the work and the sacrifice our parents, our grandparents went through so that we can be in this country and we could,
it's like finally got turned on.
So we could be in this country. And one thing I always say, and I've said this many times on now, is that the greatest problem our parents give us is options. Most people in the world don't have options. And I think sometimes the parents need to remind themselves of that, and sometimes the kids need to appreciate that. But the fact you have options is a beautiful thing. Find out what it is you're passionate about. Use technology and all the resources, the love and support your parents give you to follow that passion. And I have no doubt that you'll be successful if you put your heart and soul into it.
Okay, now, so since I'm a credentialed teacher, and 6 months ago I was teaching, now I'm going to teach briefly. All right, students. What's the most important subject in school? Hint, it's not math. It's not science. It's English. That's the most important subject in school. In my career as a working scientist, many, many times I saw good scientists marginalized because they weren't good at explaining why they were doing what they were doing and what their results meant. You have to be good at language to be effective. So look, I love science, career scientists, but English is more important than science, okay? And the second thing, I want to emphasize what the Assembly member said. One of the things that makes the United States special is that people are supposed to be able to decide for themselves what they want to do. Right? You have to find what you love and then persuade someone to pay you to do it. New York City is full of people who act on stage a few months out of the year and work as waiters the rest of the year and are very happy. New York City is full of people like that. You don't have to have a technical background to be happy and successful in the United States. In fact, among my college classmates from Princeton, the ones who are running the world are all the people who major in history and government and stuff like that. And those of us who are scientists are sort of working for them. Okay? Choose whatever you like the best and do it. And recognize you'll probably have more than one career in your life. You know, I didn't know that when I was your age. I go, I am going to be a scientist. Okay. 25 years later, well, now I'm going to be a teacher. 5 years later, now I'm going to work for a congressman. I mean, things will really change. So the biggest thing you need to know is to be adaptable, to be good at language, and to do what you like, and make sure the technology works for you, and you don't work for yourself.
Very, very well said, Chris. And you know, my messaging is actually very similar to what Chris said. And you know, when you follow your heart, when you do something that you really, really enjoy, when you have fun, then it's no longer work. And when you do that, you know, life becomes just a fun playground. And that's really what I recommend for all these kids here. So you're all building startups. If you're building a startup that addresses what is really important for you, then you're actually having fun and it's no longer work. So I think that's it can be a very, very transformative experience if you just manage to follow what your heart would like to do. And secondly, to really understand what you would like to do, like Chris said, you know, teaching and learning chemistry and then working for a congressman, right? You're basically changing tracks. And it's important for us to figure out, you know, what is that one thing that you would like to do? And here's the secret sauce to figuring out what is that one thing you would like to do? What you would like to do? And it's very simple. It's very simple, and it's basically one thing. What you need to do is go back deep into yourself, into the inner recesses of your heart, and just shut your mind down. And how do you do that? One word, meditation, right? If you meditate, you can just shut your mind down just like 10, 15 minutes a day. Just sit quietly. The answers will come very magically from the universe. And you will start aligning yourself with the purpose for which you came to this planet Earth. And then it becomes a fantastic ride. Thank you so much.
Todd Saratoga, the Sam Todd Semester, and welcome out to the front. And then we also have Mr. Ramaswamy.
Launching a session in Santa Clara, and that will start in the next few weeks, very shortly. Then we have Manish Suvarna, and he's a Stanford graduate, involved with many of our efforts to run this in the community. He's been an advisor because he's constantly providing feedback in terms of how we can tweak the model. So he's an investor locally, he's launching his own startup right now. We don't know what it is, it's supposed to be startup, but he's a busy man, so he's taking time for us, thank you. And Amit Singh, you know, he was basically instrumental for getting our program off the ground because Amit, you know, he does an amazing job of connecting with the kids. He ran the program in Saratoga, and now he's basically the mentor for all our instructors at all our locations. You know, he's an advisor, and you know, he does a bunch of different things. You know, he's an investor, he's the president of a company, but he takes the time because for him, the growth and success of the kids is very important. Avi Bhatnagar, who's the senior director at a security company, and he's been running the program in San Leandro. And we have Gary Kasser, who actually ran the program in Fremont last year. He and I used to work in IBM together. He's a financial whiz, and he does financial consulting now, and this guy is amazing. Then we have Archana Kulkarni, and she's a developer, part of the Silicon Valley economy, and she and Lochan were partnered with the program in San Jose. And I had many, many conference call sessions with them because they were truly very interested to see how they could help out the kids. And they were always trying to see how they could tweak the model and make it slightly better. Amazing. And that's Lochan, Narvik, and Lochan, Archana. Lochan also works in high tech, and you know, he has some very, very innovative ideas, constantly trying to tweak the model. Thank you, Lochan, for what you did. And then William Kokarna, he's the CEO of their startup, and William Kokarna, the session in Washington. And we also have Reena Gupta somewhere. Yes, Reena and Willis actually ran the, you all saw her on Women in Tech panel, right? Anybody remembers Reena? So basically it was Reena's idea to launch it in Pleasanton. So now the community of Pleasanton, San Ramon, and Dublin, they benefit from the launch of this. And the mayor was here, he said he would like to have at least 10 more sessions in San Jose. So we have committed to run actually 2 more sessions. So we'll have 3 sessions in fall in the city of San Jose in various locations. And we have identified already leaders and mentors who will actually be running the program in the Santa Teresa area. If you're interested to teach in any of the locations, please reach out to us because it's a pretty simple format we have. We already have the course curriculum. All we need is an instructor and we are able to roll it out in any city in America. In fact, in fall, we are actually rolling it out in the city of, in the suburbs of Chicago, in the suburbs of Charlotte, North Carolina, and then also in Oakland. So there are 3 new locations at least. So we'll take it to 12 locations and potentially a few more in San Jose next year. And I think these are our judges, so let's give them a big round of applause. Okay, Jack, I'm going to turn it over to Shivam and we'll run through this five-minute format. He's already walked through it, so we'll run through this. We are hoping we'll be out of here before 6, so it should not take more than an hour for us to run through all these pitches. I've seen them on the slide deck. These kids are amazingly creative. You're in for a treat.
Yeah, so we have that news and yeah, you're in here.
Okay, so where's that news?
I am Giovanna Gonzalez Rojas, I'm 14, and I am the CMO, marketing designer at SetNews.
Hello, my name is Giovanna Gonzalez Rojas, I am the CFO strategist and PR of SetNews.
So the problem that SetNews is trying to solve is that children in San Diego are not informed of events, news, and activities that are available in the city nearby. I'm a high schooler, and I don't know where to look for internships and jobs, and what I do, they're already all filled out. What do I do?
So our solution is to make an app for children or students in San Leandro to get informed or notified about events via digital.
Who will SetNews be for? SetNews is audience for experiencing grade level, state, college, and use case scenario.
Other use case scenarios are for middle schoolers. There are these sports, tryouts for sports. We also have clubs for after school activities. We also have our study interest at Civil War testing, which we have. And we also have, it's our foreign language, because that's when we start thinking about Spanish and French and Mandarin. So
another use scenario would be for high schoolers, where we have the PhDs, college prep, and city groups for us to pass and succeed in our high school education.
So this is a large brief of how the path would have looked like. So you see there are different types of categories for high schoolers, middle schoolers, and elementary schoolers. For example, middle schoolers would have internships, like high schoolers would have internships, and middle schoolers would just have foreign language or not at all.
Our app is specialized in community, so we are working on three areas. One of them would be to make it easier for the Silicon Valley youth to access information and to build stronger communities. The second would be to build a community and become friends and learn how to network ourselves. A third would be to centralize a solution for community development.
The way we would market our product is made by email or mailing each other what is everything. Another way would be monthly newsletters, because I know some elementary schools do newsletters still. So we would tell the school to advertise themselves in newsletters. You also might want to advertise yourself on Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, and other social media.
Who are we competing with? We are competing with Scholastic News, but in all honesty, there is no other application or website that does what we're trying to do. San Leandro isn't well informed of what is around us and what other activities are available for us. So Scholastic News would help us reach, help us inform the students of San Leandro. Our goal would be to test a program in San Leandro and get user input feedback so we can iterate and improve the product.
One or two minutes. In June, we'll have our initial research plan, so we'll know what we need to do for the week.
So what are the things
and see if any, and we see if the others is actually needed. We'll have to be. And near September is when we're going to start working on the demo or the draft of the app. We may also still continue on our knowledge and knowledge of CSS and
for marketing outreach, you will go to local meetings and events, you'll go to social media, and you'll appeal to stay-at-home moms who are looking to go part of full-time jobs to provide health and wellness for their families. Our key consists of rented jobs, all of and we call, and we have a up team in zero, and our general team is one. For our financial model, we will get company delivers 60 meals per month, and a chef will cook 25 meals per month. Off of that, we'll make $42,000 a year, and we will make $5 million in 5 years. We released an app on the website and our article by date is November 6th.
Can I get a raise of hands? How many of you guys come back from a stressful day at work and wish that your food would be automatically? So this is basically what our app does. Our app delivers food.
Continue. So all judges are judges in evasion.
So the components are that up here in the bottom, and the top part has a hole where people can walk into the trash can, if you will, you push it in over there, and throw it in the trash. And then we also, like, we think of adding, like, a big contraption here, on the side here, so, like, the machine will, like, open up and pick up the trash via artificial intelligence. And it would, like, circulate around the cars, moving cars, like, picking up the trash, and... Oh, and this isn't up to scale, it's going to be like upscale, so... And our business model is to work with ACI, Alameda County Industries, and Waste Management, which are the companies in our community where they pick up the trash, that pick up the our community. And we'd like to work with them so that when we go over to talk to like parts such as Chicago Park and Winter Park, they could see that we're being like supported by these two big companies that help out. That help pick up the trash and go put it to them. Our marketing strategy is to use this to use the prototype, and then after that contact Waste Management and CCI to be working, and then after that deploy ALT to local parks and get in the parks.
Alright, so the only competition we know of right now is Roomba or Supercube. So what makes our idea so special? We want to deploy ALT in local parks, unlike competition we mentioned earlier. They only pick up around like, offices or houses. We want to think bigger than that and pick up some fields and then not looking for So here's the timeline. By August, we'll start gathering materials for ALT. By October, we'll start moving in more models. By November, to May, we start building ALT. By June, we'll start making deals with ALT, ECI, and Waste Management. And by 2018, we'll start deploying ALT.
Thank you.
cause of death for people under the conditions. The way we're going to solve this is by providing a dispenser that will only dispense your medicine at the time that your medical professional says you need to take it.
So our business model is that we're going to sell our product to pharmacies, and then the pharmacy will offer this option to the patient, and the patient can pay not to use it. It's just a provider.
This is a way to reduce overdose in the United States. We have a direct line with law enforcement if tampering is ever detected, and communication is possible with a medical professional for any needs. We have a smart technology via Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, and we aim to create a database that will prevent doctor shopping.
So we'll be contacting local pharmacies for marketing, and then eventually we hope to build a pharmacy chain so we can get the pregnant. So some of our competition which has a similar sensor, and open physicians can access it, as well as the card that was included, but it only dispenses one head. That doesn't work with normal dispenser, which is simple, but it tends to be risky to take conversations with long color. Finally, there's an eco-compromise, which can only be accessible to me, and it's hard to create open, but anyone with a key can open it, and it's also based on patient responsibility.
As you can see, none of our competitors are connected to the internet or have a direct line of communication to the medical professional. This is our team.
So with a monthly subscription fee of $3 per month, we hope to start with 2,500 pharmacies and 10 customers per pharmacy, and grow to 64,000 out of 67,000 in the United States pharmacies, and 200 customers per pharmacy, generating a total revenue of $400 million. So all of our passengers will be online. And our product is called PAM, Full Automatic Machine. So this is a demodelable prototype. The front of it has a touch screen where you can view the weather, check how much time is left until the next dose, and listen to music. And at the top, there's a fingerprint scanner so that when it's time to take the medication, you can scan your finger and then only will the next be where you're sitting. This is an instant delivery dispenser. So there are three components, three compartments for up to 3 MCC delivery. This is side two.
Our device will also have phone compatibility to an app that will be available on your app store. The function of the app is to help facilitate a doctor-patient communication as well as set reminders. As you can see on the home page, there is a connect button where you will enter the serial number given to you by your pharmacist. There's also another option to chat directly to your doctor or pharmacist, like I said before, if you have any questions or concerns. And there's a reminders page to see what prescription you need to take at what time and how much, as well as a profile page to see any of your past, current, or possible future prescriptions. There's a need for this because 76% of 100 million adults who are 50 plus are on daily prescription in the United States. 80% of the global opioid supply is consumed by the United States, and it is estimated that by 2022, the global pharma market will reach $1.12 trillion. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
1.1 million birds and bird animals die each year due to plastic and water pollution. That's roughly equal to the population of Dallas, Texas.
84% of tropical packing waste is recyclable. Only 40% reaches the bin. That's less than half.
More ratings and reviews for a bigger amount of restaurants in our go-rated section of our app.
Innovated by making our products more accessible and cheaper, and we also
This is the live, this is the demo of our user interface, which Karthik and I built. And this is the home screen. So if you click, you can sign up as a tutor or a student. You click the tutor button. You're brought to the major tutor profile screen. You can choose what location you're in and what grade level and subject you're teaching and what course you're teaching. We're still debugging this app, so errors still pop up every now and then. This is the pay or hosting fee screen, and the service is free for the first month and $5 per month after. And transactions occur through PayPal. So the tutors activate their profile, and this is an example of a tutor profile. We just picked Albert Einstein as an example, and the tutors edit their bio and show what they teach. This is the sign-up screen for the students. Once they input their information, they're brought to the browse for tutor screen. This is where they choose their location and their search criteria for what course they want help in. And these are the search results, and these are examples of tutors and what the results would look like. And this is the transaction screen where the students pay the tutors and 5% of the transaction goes to us and they do that through PayPal. And this is what we've come up with you guys so far.
Thank you for listening.
So are there students that actually participated but that are not pitching today? Any students that participated not pitching? We just have one. Okay, so we would like to, you know, we have participation certificates. We would like to give it out to the instructors so that you can actually hand it over to your students. So we have to, so before you leave, you know, instructors of each location, please pick up the participation certificates and then arrange some time to meet your students so that you can hand it off. So there are many students who joined the class, but they are not here today. Yes, and the other teams that are actually pitching, they will get to pick up the participation certificate. Because we have the first three spots, we have something to give out. And the remaining can actually pick up the participation certificate. So please don't forget. Right.
Display for the some technical problem we have. Don't be focused on the building.
good yet.
So, say more by the so, you all want to start to get happy. You all want to start to
college systems. Our product for business application, since there's 14.5 million salespeople in the United States, CallNow will automatically connect to CRMs, which are customer relationship management systems such as Salesforce, and will download contacts and follow-up calls for that day. After each call, CallNow will convert those requests and update the CRM's follow-up rather than the salespeople having to go in and do it then.
Shows up on your screen. When you press the first button, it selects contacts. You can select
select the people that you want to call to form the committees. You can also add contacts manually, which is the second button. And then when you decide who you're going to call, you press go, and then you'll call people that you agree.
Thank you all for listening and graciously waiting. And we really hope that we want to promote road safety. And if you guys are really interested, then we have a center to come back to where you guys can meet us at your class. Thank you for listening.
When and how.
set 118 billion homeowners in the world via retailers such as Home Depot and Lowe's.
Then you'll have a